I have to do what? Why do I have to do it?
You have to create your relic.
No, I don't.
Hey, everyone, you should be seeing us.
Oh, what is the name of our force commander? Who in the chat wants the honor?
To be force commander?
Who's force commander?
There we go. Hey, Matt, welcome, everyone. Who's going to be our force commander? What a force commander is, we don't know.
It's this guy. See his face? It's the guy from the opening cinematic.
Oh.
He's Force Commander.
Force Commander. What the fuck is this? This is Dawn of War 2, part of the Warhammer 40,000 series.
Now, this is the important part.
Yeah.
A lot of people, we need to play this. You need to play this. Mm-hmm. They say, it's just like Helldivers.
Is that what they've said?
That's what they have said.
Oh. Okay. Hold on.
I've seen videos. I know they are 150% wrong. They're so wrong they have broken the rules of probability. That's how wrong they are.
Okay, cool.
So, we gotta pick a name. Huh?
I got the thing.
I got the thing.
You got the Twatcher. You have the randomizer.
I got the randomizer from the Twatcher, and I will use it.
Hi, everybody. Welcome.
Chat lottery.
Chat lottery. Subs and mods.
Just subs.
Just subs.
Rebel Base.
Oh, how funny.
Okay.
That has a nice hint of irony to it, that a Rebel Base will be our force commander.
Rebello.
What's a Warhammer? I don't know. I know they have lots of figurines. Rebello.
Rebello Bay.
Ooh.
I have no more characters.
That's great. Rebello Bay. Nope, that's it.
That makes no sense.
That's it, Rich.
That makes no sense, Jack.
That's it. That's all you got.
Look at that. Look at that huge space for a name.
That's very strange. I will say that. Thank you. But, you know. I don't know. I don't quite get it, but
I was going to come up with some goofy sounding name. I really can't. So I'm just going to go, you know.
Oh, Rebel. Well,
full on vanilla because it fits.
I like
because
the Rebel Bay, but this is fine.
Difficulty.
Choose if you're new to real-time strategy games. Choose if you've played real-time strategy games before.
Well, I've played them. I don't like them historically.
I'll go new then. You know, and we're new to the series. The easiest difficulty, Rich.
All right.
Great.
Subsector Aurelia.
Subsector Aurelia.
This cluster of worlds stands on the very edge of the Imperium of Man. What? From this frontier came the Blood Ravens, a chapter of the Emperor's own Space Marines.
Once and for all. Oh, he was talking under that gunfire.
Obviously, he was saying
Captain
people
Davian
shoot things.
Fool and a handful of Space Marines lead the raw recruits defending these worlds.
Rich isn't fed up yet, but
another Space Marine
joins this
desperate
battle. Oh no, I'm a long ways from
a newly promoted commander, ready to lead in our darkest hour. You are this Space Marine.
Jack, I hate everything.
And you will tip the balance toward victory.
You have a bullet in your head, just permanently lodged.
Was that is it a bullet or is that some kind of science fiction thing? Is it an implant?
Oh, I like to think of it as a bullet, just like someone shot you in the head. And you're not taking that shit.
My assumption was brain implant thing.
Hmm, okay. Sure, we'll see.
Commander Rebel Base.
Commander Rebel Base. I love it. This is an older game, right?
A few years. I don't think it's in the grand scheme of things it's that old.
All right.
Calderas. That's fine. We Blood Ravens select our initiates from this world's fierce warriors. Calderas is the cradle and the future of our chapter.
Hi, I've
now the orcs would take it from us.
It's pronounced Rebel Base.
We cannot allow.
Rebel Base.
Rebel Base. I am your commander, Rebel Base. We will go to war now. Total war done. The war. Yeah, yeah.
Stay in cover. Kill the
orcs that are out in the open.
Rebel base, we'll talk about this in a little bit. Let's let Rick get in the
game. Can you reach the remote for a second? I got shit in my lap.
This is Captain Davian Fool.
Thank you, Jack.
In command
You're welcome.
Here on Calderas.
You're welcome.
We are right. Battling the orcs that threaten this world.
How's the sound for you all?
You have dropped right into the combat zone.
I did watch some videos on this. It looks like things take cover, which I'm not used to seeing in real-time strategy games.
Yeah,
I'm not a huge fan of the genre.
Uh-huh.
Move north and provide
Everyone's
support.
Gonna go, so this game did it, and that game did it, and this game did it. Alright,
if,
all right.
if you're in a pause mode. Can you turn the game audio down a little bit? Looks like the game audio is pretty on par with our audio, so let's move the desktop audio way down. There. That looks good.
All right.
A lot of explodey stuff and booming noises and boom, boom, boom.
All right.
Okay, rendezvous with allied troops.
How do we select units? How do we move?
Oh, it looks like also your resolution is off.
Yeah, I'm going to
fix that.
Game, I hit escape to go to menus. There we go.
I saw that Brick Jaeger. The Switch?
Yeah.
The Nintendo Switch has a little kickstand, so you can like set it up. Like, you know, if you're flying in an airplane or something, or just, you know, not in your base, it's got a little kickstand. And while it's in kickstand mode, you can't charge it because the charger is on the bottom, which is a little silly.
Wait, I'm looking for resolution, and it's not in here.
Graphics?
Maybe ultra? From the main menu. Right? Can I get to the main menu?
Up there.
Game options. Effects density, brightness. That's not what I need to change at all.
Huh. Can you like scroll down?
No.
Okay. Thanks, Articus Rex.
Like, I can't see everything on the screen. There's like things that apparently I can click on that I can't see, and that's kind of important for me. I don't know what...
You guys can see them. Why can you see them and we can't see them?
Something to do with the TV. I'm just going to quit the game and start again.
Yeah.
We'll skip the cutscene if we can.
Those little buttons on the side, on you know, the like right up here, you guys could see those, but they were cut off for us for
maybe,
some
maybe it wouldn't let me change it because we were in the game,
that
not
could be.
In the main menu.
That could be.
Sometimes when it's already running, the game gets finicky about change. All
Absolutely.
Right.
That's
I
fine.
Get it.
No, that's fine.
I get it.
They say change resolution in main menu, yeah.
Yeah.
This is not a negative. We're not making fun of the game. Everybody just settle down for like 2 seconds.
I don't need Steam's menu. I need options.
Options.
Oh my god, there's much more things to click on. There we go. Yeah, look at that. Let's kick that all the way up to where it needs to be, to where it's the proper thing for the thing.
Okay.
That is my thing.
Great. Except we're thinging proper now.
Well, it accepted it, but
oh, it didn't like that.
Didn't like that.
Probably too high.
Let's try again.
That's fine.
We're gonna try again, Jack.
Let's rock and roll, Rich. So while we're waiting here, what did you think of the Switch? Did you see any news on the Switch?
All I cared about were the game announcements.
Right, and a lot of companies like on Twitter and stuff have already like announced that like, hey, this game is coming to Switch. You know, like a lot of indie titles coming to Switch.
A lot of AAA games.
Less so.
Oh, a lot of things I could probably play on Steam?
Yeah, probably.
Oh, I could probably play these things that are on Steam? Yeah, oh, so at the end, yeah. As I've been saying all along,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's going to be the interesting Mario game and there's going to be the interesting Zelda game.
Nope.
Mm-hmm. I'm not particularly interested in Mario Kart or Smash. Those mm-hmm. will probably be there too. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be, for me, there's going to be just those two games and just those two games.
But...
And you know what?
What?
Maybe it's worth it for just those two games. Maybe it is.
Yeah.
But you're gonna like every fucking Nintendo console since the 64.
Uh-huh.
You're gonna have shit third party support.
That's what it's looking like.
From the cube on.
It's looking like the hardware, because there's no real gimmick this time.
Yeah.
It looks like it will be much easier to make games or port games to the Switch. Whoa.
It crashed.
Oh.
I think.
Okay, what? You gotta take down that resolution. If you can.
I think I just tried that. Are we full crash?
No, I see you moving over there. It's closed Dawn of War.
Alright, that's a full crash.
Alien of Seven. By no real gimmick, I mean, say, like, the DS has two screens. And so if you port your game over to the DS and you had it like a small game, you need to accommodate the two screens. The same with the Wii U. The same with the Wii with motion controls. Those are the gimmicks that you needed to change your game to accommodate the gimmicks. Whereas with the Switch, for example, Nichols announced that Binding of Isaac Afterbirth will be available for the Switch. They don't need to do anything to make it Switch compatible.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a screen. There's no real gimmick. It has the gimmick of plugging it into the TV. But no, you know what? Does that make sense? No real gimmick?
No, it's a gimmick. The whole thing's a gimmick.
But it's easier to port games to it.
All right.
Be with me here.
Will they...
Be with me here.
Will they... Will they bother? Because it'll end up having a low install base?
I don't know, man. That price point is pretty good.
The Zelda launch title will help them.
And that price point is insane.
What is it?
$300.
Oh, wow.
Insanely
good.
That's a low price, is what I'm saying, for a new console. I think
that's a lot of money for just Mario and Zelda.
On the go. Mario, Zelda on the go, man.
I don't care about on the go.
You don't care about it on the go. I'm
super
excited.
What the fuck do I give a shit about on the go for?
I'm excited for on the go.
What, am I going to play it while I'm driving? Then when I get to the place where I'm going, I'm going to need to do things at the place where I'm going.
Oh, here we go. Gino Suave puts it nice. It doesn't have a gimmick in the same sense that the Vita doesn't have a gimmick. It totally has a gimmick, but you can totally ignore the gimmick, is I guess what I'm trying to say. As a game developer, you can ignore
all right.
the gimmick.
Okay. You could have said the same thing about the Wii. You could have said the same thing.
But no, you did need to, like Nintendo said, you needed to put stuff on that second screen.
You put bullshit on there and you don't focus on it.
But... That's something you needed to accommodate.
All right.
You don't need to accommodate that. This is, you know, this is copy-paste porting. Calderas. You can play in the crapper, right? This is now my bathroom console. Absolutely. Okay, here we go.
Now I can see the things that I need to click on.
Great.
This is useful.
Great. We're here.
All right, move north. Moving your units.
Yeah, and that's true. It all depends on how... Where you want it to move to. And finally, click once with the right mouse button. It all depends on how open Nintendo is going to be with their games. But I think there's strong movement. I think the type of games...
All right, now what? Are they automatically attacked?
They're automatically attacking, it seems.
What is this? What is he doing?
You only have one. You only have one going that way.
And he just charges them. All right.
Well, your other guys are just sitting back
there. He automatically kills the things. I don't know what's going on in a real-time oh my god.
I mean, we'll probably get a Switch, because we'll probably need to do Zelda. Probably get a couple Switches, if we can.
Yeah. What am I doing? They're just shooting automatically.
Yeah, you're moving them to where you want them to shoot stuff.
No, I needed to know what she was saying. Don't. What are their hotkeys? Oh my god. Oh my god. Things are just happening. I have no time to adjust what I'm doing because I. God, these real-time games are so stressful. By the way.
Yeah.
This is nothing like Helldivers.
No, so far, this is nothing
absolutely like nothing like Helldivers. If, you people all lied to me.
If I were to look at a screenshot of this, I might say, hey, this kind of looks top-down isometric like Helldivers does, right? But no, this is nothing like Helldivers. Oh, there's some sort of audio fuck-up, too. What is happening?
It's all, you know what? Everything's fine.
Oh my god, look at that. There's a whole thing happening over there.
Do you tell them what to attack?
I don't know.
Yeah, I know about the hotkey. How about... attacking it? Yeah, let me just click on and read this shit in the middle of a battle. Oh god, real-time strategy games. Why...
That's true. From Software is working on something for the Switch. There's a lot of third-party developers like Bethesda. They're putting Skyrim over to the Switch, so they're going to be working on stuff for the Switch. Like, I think there is going to be slightly more support. Whether or not it's worth it is all whether or not you care about mobile gaming, because that's the big thing with the Switch. For me, I love mobile gaming. I do it all the time. So it will, you know, probably be something I get a lot of use out of. I know I've seen a couple, like, people make, like, makeshift, like, handheld Steam boxes. I would love a handheld Steam box. Just, you know, something to play the little indie side-scroller shit games. I would love that. And so that's what I'm thinking of the Switch as, hopefully. It's just a tiny little Steam box.
What's their range?
Your guys?
Is there an indicator for their range? Where they shoot?
Nope.
What's that? I got a thing. These games are such a clusterfuck. I don't even know what I did.
But you did it, Rich. You made it to the end.
Who are these guys? Do I control them too? Do I get? What do these indicators mean? How do I adjust this? What is going on?
There are little book things over there. Maybe you could read those.
Oh my god.
War gear is special equipment that makes your characters more powerful. Enemies will sometimes drop war gear when they die. To pick up a piece of war gear, click on it with the left mouse button. You will have access to that war gear once you have completed your current mission.
Eight.
Oh, sorry, rotoscopic. Yep. That is my job. Let's see here.
I'm not proceeding to the next objective. I don't even know what the fuck I'm doing.
Just keep reading. It's fine. Rotoscopic says the new Mario Kart game for the Switch is literally Mario Kart 8, but with battle mode maps. They just decided to finish the game. To release it on Switch. Your thoughts? LOL, nibble my nipples. Yeah, they're just like re-releasing a bunch of games for Switch, including stuff like Mario Kart 8.
The same maps?
Yeah. Well, but like with a battle mode now.
Oh, well, that's so exciting.
It's fine. They're propping up their launch. I mean, it's not looking good. It's not looking good for Nintendo. Like, did you hear that their stock price dropped after the announcement?
Yeah.
Because like their investors are not excited about this. About the Switch. Now, move the cursor to the location you wish to throw the grenade at, and then click the... It is... They are not excited.
Look, the only thing you want on a Nintendo... Look, the problem with Nintendo,
yeah,
as I see it, mm-hmm, the problem with Nintendo is that they make hardware.
Yeah. No. I'm with you.
New Mario game? Oh, that looks neat. New Zelda game? Oh, that looks neat.
Uh-huh.
You gotta buy their special $300 piece of hardware to do it with the gimmicks and everything.
Mm-hmm.
If they just came out on like Steam or something, that would be fabulous.
Oh, it would be. It really would be.
Oh, yeah, it's on PlayStation. That's great. Mario's probably going to be a fun game. Zelda's probably going to be a fun game. And then,
I'll be honest with you, though. The Mario game looked really fucking weird.
What's so weird about it to you, Jack?
Mario standing next to real-looking people.
You say that as if 80% of that trailer weren't Mario in new, weird, bizarre, colorful, interesting landscapes.
There were new, weird, bizarre,
lots of them.
That
lots of them.
Him in New York was weird. It was weird seeing him next to a normal person.
Okay.
That was weird.
Why is that? I don't think it's inherently bad.
I'm not saying bad. I'm saying
especially
weird.
When large chunks of the game look like they're in the same kind of colorful, fanciful locations that Mario games always take place in.
What I'm worried about is the what's the Sonic the Hedgehog game that came out late in
life?
Yeah,
that's why everybody's worried, and it's a dumb thing to make, just because it visually looks... You know what?
Visually,
Sonic and real people, Mario and real people, these two games are going to be the exact same thing.
It's
space marines on a planet shooting at aliens.
It's a trend,
and space
Rich.
Machines shooting at aliens on a planet. Helldivers and Dawn of War 2 are the exact same thing. You see the flaw in that logic.
I'm not saying
the absolute
perfect logic. Utter,
anybody who's saying it's going to be just like Sonic 06 is a fucking moron, including you, because you just said that.
There is a trend of someone not understanding.
I think Nintendo is bright enough not to emulate the most hated video game of the last 20 years.
No. But it made, like, seeing Mario next to real people made me feel uncomfortable, visually.
He supposedly comes from New York.
Right, but then you make all New Yorkers look like Mario. And then you make a whole little world of people that look like Mario.
It's fine. It's gonna be fine.
No, it made
You're
me
worrying
feel
about
weird.
Nothing.
Made me feel funny. Made me feel funny.
Translate the rage into slang, or I don't even know what the fuck I'm doing.
You have to read the thing. You have to read the thing. All right, Gobbledygook says, if it's easy to port, why isn't Skyrim a Switch launch title? Because Nintendo is a tease. It's the significant other who only puts out once a month to make you think the sex is better than it is.
Why would anybody get excited about a 5-year-old game appearing on the Switch?
No one's excited about...
It's the dumbest fucking title to port over.
No one is excited about Skyrim coming over.
Uh-huh.
They are excited that Bethesda is on board for making games on the Switch.
By throwing them a game they made years ago.
And
that
know,
means nothing. It means absolutely nothing. With her,
it means that, hey, they've already made one. There's a possibility of more, which means there's a possibility of third-party support, like, which we all agree is what we're looking for in Nintendo releases.
Like with Arkham City on the Wii U?
Was Arkham City on the
Wii
U?
Yeah, it was.
Oh. I didn't know it was.
Yeah, yeah. Years after it was out on...
Who made that?
Else.
Who made Arkham City?
Rocksteady, who's, I think, owned by Warner Brothers.
Oh, okay. Did they make any other games for the Wii U?
I don't think so.
What other games does Rocksteady make?
Well, they made all the Batman ones.
Oh, okay.
They made the Arkham Knight, which I don't think Arkham Knight came out on the Wii U. I don't think, but I could be wrong.
I think Bethesda's a little bit bigger than Rocksteady.
Yes, they are.
I'm so, just, like, that's a bigger get.
This would not make me excited about all the new Bethesda games that are going to come out on the Wii U.
It's
and you know
about,
what? You know what?
What? They're it's gonna not be the, about Bethesda games.
They're going to be the same Bethesda games that come out on the PlayStation 4, which you probably already own.
Right.
Making it kind of useless to you that it's also coming out on the Switch?
Bethesda is a big third-party developer.
Yes.
They are on board for making a game. That opens doors.
Okay.
That opens, maybe not doors, possibilities. Possibilities.
Okay.
Don't you think?
No.
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 All right.
It's going to have a small install base, and they're going to be reluctant to make games for a small install base when they can make a game that comes out on PlayStation 4. They'll do multiplat. They'll be fine with that, probably.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's what I'm hoping for, is that it will be easy to port games over or, you know, have a multi-platform release for games. And so then anyone who wants to, say, play this one game but also play it mobily will have the option to do so.
All right, so I'm going to frag grenade.
Allied squads are units fighting on your side which you do not control. They appear with a yellow selection circle around their base.
All right, so I don't control them. All right, that's handy knowledge. That's handy knowledge.
You don't control what?
Those other guys.
Oh, okay. Beedaboo boom.
Nothing, absolutely nothing like Helldivers, except for in the most superficial ways possible.
You guys should play RimWorld. It's just like Helldivers. I am a member of chat, so you know I am trustworthy, says Sean __.
No, I clicked on the frag grenade. Why don't you use the frag grenade? Why did you leave cover? Oh my god.
It's going to be running. According to initial releases, something like the Breath of the Wild or Breath of the Wind or whatever the Zelda game is called, is going to be running at 720p, 60 frames a second, handheld, and 1080p, 60 frames a second, docked.
I don't feel like I'm doing much of anything.
Uh-huh.
Why aren't you getting behind the get behind the cover. What am I doing?
Well done, Commander.
You did it. Zocole says poor Rich sounds so stressed already. The Switch presentation was such a shame. I really wanted to like it, and then they started the wiggle and stuff. Please give Rich a hug. Oh, and LOL, fuck my cock. Karen is chairman of Rich Hugging.
Yeah.
I'm sure she will give Rich a hug when he gets home. And yeah, like all of their like weird, if you guys have seen any of their footage on their like cow milking game or any of their weird motion games, I don't know what they're doing. Holding on to old gimmicks because that's what made him a shit ton of money. But all of that stuff is crazy. Savage Engine says, I just wonder how much single player content will be released on the Switch. I'm getting tired of Nintendo being so multiplayer party game centric. Some of us prefer a game alone, looks at Rich. Yeah. Well, you know, we know for sure they got a Mario and a Zelda, and Zelda's a launch title, which they really, really needed, which of course means that it's done already and should have been a Wii U title, but they're holding
it. It's also coming out on the Wii U, I have heard.
It is coming out on the Wii U, yeah.
But nobody owns a Wii U. So you may as well just buy a Switch for it.
You may as well just buy the Switch, absolutely. Because then you can play it on the go or on the can.
What is this?
Yeah, what is that? It's a supply crate.
Open it. Destroy it for.
Is there an attack button? Oh, there you go.
I don't understand real-time strategy. I just don't.
That's all right, Rich. You can get there. You can get there.
Use frag grenades on the. Okay.
But yeah, the whole presentation, you probably didn't watch the live stream or anything.
No.
It was a little cringy. It was a little weird. It didn't have the heart. Like Miyamoto wasn't really a part of it. And
how old is he? Is he like pretty much retired at this point, or is he still really active?
I mean, he's still doing stuff. He's probably more like a. Like a Stan Lee, like a just a face of the organization, but I think he's still like overseer.
I have no idea what I did. I just moved people around and they shot at things.
You did it. You did it.
I guess I did.
That's all you need to do. Well, that was tutorial too. You leveled up people. That's great. Let's see here. Cure de Liqueur says, Jack, just to confirm, you, Jack, named your first son Jack Son, and your second son Parker. Is this correct? LOL, please have sex with me. You have it reversed. My first son is Parker. My second son is Jackson. Reversed. Anonymous says, rumor has it that Robert Zemeckis and James Cameron have a beef over who makes better movies. Box office aside, who do you side with in that beef? Who is the Biggie and who is the Tupac?
Neither of them made a good movie in 20 years.
Boom. Name me off some Zemeckis movies.
Back to the Future.
Right.
That's done. That's all you need.
Give me some more, though.
Forrest Gump.
Okay.
Used Cars.
I don't think I know that one.
Give
me some Zemeckis titles.
Apollo 13, that was Ron Howard. Why am I drawing blanks? I shouldn't be drawing blanks. You know, all of the Back to the Future movies.
Right. Castaway, they're saying.
Is that Zemeckis?
Oh, is Roger Rabbit Zemeckis?
Ooh. Oh, yeah, you're right. Oh, God, I totally forgot about Roger Rabbit.
I was about to say Cameron all the way.
Ba-bam. Cameron? Aliens?
Terminator?
He is... Yeah, and Terminator.
The Abyss?
Yeah.
Abyss is pretty rockin'.
Aliens... One of my favorite movies of all time.
Right.
But then again, so was Back to the Future. And Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Right.
I love the first Terminator. I mean, they make very different movies tonally.
They do. I'm trying to think of more Cameron movies that I love.
There's not many. There really aren't. Terminator 2.
Terminator's a big one, though. Terminator 2's awesome.
Aliens is a huge one.
Aliens.
And then you got The Abyss.
And The Abyss, which is great.
What was the Arnold Schwarzenegger one? True Lies.
True Lies is beautiful.
Is it?
It is.
It's all right.
It's beautiful.
I didn't love it.
It's beautiful. Zemeckis did Contact.
Yeah, fine.
We all know he did Avatar, and he did... And you know what?
Avatar is the most forgettable movie of all time.
It is.
Yeah, he made it. It made a ton of money. I give him credit for that. So did Titanic. Neither of them are my personal... Neither of them make my personal favorites, Avatar.
And you know, I've never seen Titanic still. I've never seen it still.
Schmaltz.
Yeah, that's what I'm sure. I might have to go Zemeckis, just because of Roger Rabbit, Back to the Future.
They're pretty tied.
But like,
just when you compare their good movies.
Like if we throw in all the crap, Zemeckis might lose because I think he's made more.
Well, you know where Zemeckis loses out?
Oh.
That creepy Uncanny Valley shit he did with the Polar Express. And what was the other one he did with the creepy Uncanny Valley people?
Oh, I don't know.
He made two. I thought he made two.
Contact is not one of the best sci-fis ever. Bad news every... I have issues with Contact.
Have you seen Contact? This is telling. I've only seen it once.
Okay.
I didn't think it was bad, but I wasn't in love with it.
Contact was one of those movies that we just had around the house. My mom really liked that one.
Mm-hmm.
I'm about to spoil the end of Contact. Obviously, it's an older movie. Spoiler alert for Contact. Had a lot of fun sci-fi in it. And I always felt... off about it. Like, I liked it. I was like, oh, yeah, Contact's fine. Jodie Foster, space stuff, you know, traveling through interdimensional. What's it and who's it? I always had a problem with it, and here's why. The end of the movie is ungodly anti-science. If you remember the end of Contact.
I remember she saw the aliens.
She goes through the big thing.
And then she wakes up, and everyone thought it was a dream because she was only gone for, like, a moment.
Right.
Yeah.
But then, she has the big Senate hearing, and she's like, I guess what I'm asking for is your faith. And that was her whole thing with Matthew McConaughey, like, faith versus science. And then, like, she gets out of the courthouse, and all these people are like, we believe in you! We have faith in you! So basically, the moral of the movie is faith is more important than facts. The moral of the sci-fi movie is anti-science.
I have not thought about it enough to analyze it like that. I just haven't.
Oh, and you know what? Like, it's one of those movies that I always liked, you know, because it was one of, like, that and Supergirl we had around, right? I don't care if Carl Sagan wrote the film. Fuck it. Ungodly anti-science. Yes, that's what I said. Whoa. I got them.
I did a thing.
Great.
I guess. We'll give him gun points, I suppose.
Yeah.
Real-time strategy with characters. That's neat.
Jack, it's still real time. Science that it, no, the ending didn't prove with science that it was real. We, the audience, get to see that the trip was real, right? Remember, like, in the you probably don't remember.
Really, so, don't remember.
Like, the real end, after all that faith bullshit, is, like, James Woods saying, like, put this away in storage, and someone going, it's funny how, you know, there is static, but there's exactly 5 hours of static on this tape. You know, like, so, like, we, the audience, knows it's real. But, like, the hero wins because people have faith without facts.
Jack, that's an excellent critique. That really is. Yeah. That really is.
But you know what? It's a fine movie overall. I like Jodie Foster. I think she's a good actress. That has that creepy Jake Busey in it. Man, he's a creepy actor.
I just remember Matthew McConaughey and Jodie Foster. I don't remember Jake Busey.
He's like the religious zealot who wants to destroy the machine and ends up blowing it up at that one point. I know.
I really don't remember.
Like I said, it was this in Supergirl, so I've seen it a bunch. So a lot of it's burned into my head. I am totally not misremembering this movie, by the way. Contact for the next review. Yeah, Rich and I will do contact for the next review. Absolutely. In position. Solo 5-6. I am not misremembering contact. This is how it goes. Arrival is better. Arrival is a wonderful movie. One of the best of last year. One of the best of last year.
This doesn't have some of the annoying, like, base building stuff so far. In real-time strategy games, I'm down with that. That's one less cluster for my fuck.
Gobbledygook's all the...
Or one less fuck for my cluster. Whatever.
All the science-y stuff in Arrival was actual science fiction. There were schmaltz in there, but it worked within the science fiction that they set up. No, Arrival's great. Arrival's wonderful. And you know, most of Contact is really good. I just really didn't like the ending. But most of the science stuff is pretty good. They're saying that that Cameron has less hits, but also less stinkers. Zemeckis is more of a workhorse.
What does the green and yellow mean?
What green and yellow?
Dots. There's green and yellow dots. I don't know what the difference is. Exposure? What are you people doing? Get your butts over here and. I have no idea what I'm... They're just doing things.
Seriously, if you've never seen Chest... I have not seen Chest. Okay, green is high cover, yellow is light cover.
So green is high.
Green is high cover, yellow is light cover.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Shiva. And other people, too. Thank you, thank you. Jack, they end the exact same way. They're the exact same movie, like Helldivers and Dawn of War. Gobbledygooks. Don't you be crazy now. Don't you be crazy now. And you can zoom in if you want. I don't know. Whoa. All
right, all right.
There you go. So to end the Zemeckis Cameron... The great Zemeckis Cameron debate.
They both have great films.
They both have great films.
And they both have awful films.
Yeah, there you go. If you had to choose now I'm giving you a harsh choice. You have to choose only one.
From their heyday?
And any director, but you can only choose one director's movies to watch. Or, you know, any movie in their repertoire, but you can only choose one director.
Well, it depends on what I'm in the mood for. It really does.
Yeah, I guess that's true. I might...
Can you really compare Who Framed Roger Rabbit to Aliens? Can you do that? Does that make sense?
If I'm gonna horseshoe myself, if I'm going to force myself to choose one, I might choose Cameron. I might choose James Cameron. Terminator's great all the time. T2 is a fun movie. Aliens is a fun movie. I would probably, on any given day, rather watch his movies. That's all.
Whose movie?
James Cameron's.
James Cameron's?
Yeah. It's tough because then you're giving up Who Framed Roger Rabbit and you're giving up Back to the Future. Zeus.
Back to the Future and Who Framed Roger Rabbit are more... As much as I love, like, Aliens, definitely one of my favorite movies.
Yeah, yeah.
Who Framed Roger Rabbit, a lot easier to watch multiple times.
Maybe.
If you're going to do that, you can only watch one for the rest of your life, or Desert Island, or that bullshit.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I'm doing.
You're taking Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Yeah,
or Back to the Future.
You're about to, you know, your plane is about to crash land, and you can only save the collected works of James Cameron or the collected works of Robert Zemeckis.
Yeah, you're going with Zemeckis.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Maybe, I don't know. Terminator.
Which feels another, you know, kind of a bleak, serious sci-fi movie. Alien, bleak, serious sci-fi movie. Abyss, serious sci-fi movie. Mm-hmm. Avatar, forgettable. Titanic, blah.
Yeah.
Zemeckis, you get Back to the Future 1, 2, 3. You get Forrest Gump. You get Who Framed Roger Rabbit. More, you know, enjoyable movies to watch. You're gonna be depressed on that desert island.
I suppose. Yeah, we have two different scenarios here. What we have is, like, which one are you more inclined to watch on an everyday basis, and your desert island picks. I might have to asterisk this. To secure a relay, first select one of your units, then place the mouse cursor over the relay and click the right mouse button. Do not move that unit until the relay is... All right, Humberto Cabbage Patch says, R.I.P. Moki. Bassoons!
That's we have a moment from the last stream that we might have to make a highlight.
Excellent. Yeah?
Yeah.
Moki died?
Yeah. Moki was a support.
Uh-huh.
You know how I feel about sports.
I do. I know you don't like
Moki
sports.
Moki really wanted to be on the squad, though.
Okay.
So I brought Moki.
And he died.
It's been gloriously. Kind of gloriously.
Was it all in one chunk, or do I need to edit it together?
If you want, like, some setup with me talking about, all right, I'll bring it. Like, you might need to edit some of that in. But just when it happened,
okay.
Moki panicked.
Yep.
Didn't take a shot at the Thin Man, which is what I would have done with Moki.
Yeah, yeah.
Panicked, and then... The Thin Man shot and critted them.
Oh.
And I broke out in hysterics.
Okay.
Because at the start of the mission, uh-huh. I predicted, like, exactly what would happen. Like, Moki's going to be the first one to die. And it played out, perfect. Like, exactly
perfect.
As I thought.
Okay. Send me the link. And to whoever was asking about Wheel of the Worst, and if you have a DVD, yeah, send a DVD. If you don't have a VHS copy of whatever for the wheel, send a DVD. We can put those on the wheel as well. That's great. Also, bassoons. I don't know if anyone has told you about the great bassoon search of 2017. Hold on, we're just learning.
See, it's another rule of mine that I need to follow at all times.
Yeah.
Bad idea to learn a game midstream.
Yeah. Bassoons. Yeah. So, someone tweeted at me a week and a half ago and said, "Hey, my wife and I are big fans of the show. One of our favorite lines is from A Best of the Worst, where you say, and for some reason, there's bassoons. Or there's a bassoon. But I can't remember the episode. Can you remember the episode?"
above the relay indicates how many squad members still need to be reinforced. You can also reinforce at the drop pod that delivered your squads at the beginning of the mission.
Okay.
Great.
Sorry.
No problem.
I have to learn
absolutely.
The game.
Absolutely. No, and you know what? We can take our time, Rich. We don't need to rush through this stuff. So I retweeted it and said, hey, someone help this guy out. I remember me saying that in a best of the worst. Like, oh, yeah, that sounds like something I would say. Like, and then there were bassoons. And I could remember myself saying it, but I couldn't remember the episode. So I put it out on the internet. No one was biting. And after a little bit, you know, some people were like, hey, did you find that episode yet? The bassoons, this sounds really familiar. And so I started, like, in the background while I was doing other work, randomly watching old Best of the Worst episodes that I thought it was. For example, in the, if you remember that, like, one of the first Best of the Worst I was on is Aftermath. And they have that, like, whole action scene at the end with, like, cartoon sound effects. And I was like, oh, maybe it's in that when we were talking about the action scene during the cartoon. No, not in that. Kept watching them, couldn't find it. People then, like, Beefcake set up a spreadsheet, and a bunch of people, like, were watching different episodes to find the right moment when I said, for some reason, there's a bassoon. And we could not find it, and it was honestly driving me up the wall because I could hear myself say it. This is something I've said in an episode of Best of the Worst. Is this an episode that was up on Blip and Jay took down, and you know, it's re-edited on YouTube for some reason, and he took out me saying bassoon? Where's me saying bassoon? It was maddening, Rich. It was absolutely maddening. But then someone found it for me.
Uh-huh.
And the twist, the M. Night Shyamalan twist, is that it wasn't in a Best of the Worst at all. It was in a first 4 hours of Soma. When you said it's not, the only reason it's scary is because you walk you walk around, and I go, yeah, you just walk around, and then suddenly there's a bassoon. Which is a pretty funny line. But because this fan had thought it was the Best of the Worst, that was my mindset. I wasn't even thinking about first 4 hours of a previously recorded. Say tuba. Tuba. Tuba bassoon. Oh, thank you, X-Menta. So in any case, that was my harrowing bassoon tale. Thank you for everyone who was trying to help me find the bassoon. Beefcake, your spreadsheet was super helpful. Also, it was kind of fun, like, rewatching older episodes of Best of the Worst. I had forgotten half of the movies we watched, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
And then, you know, we talk about it later and go, this movie's totally forgettable, and it was. I'd forgotten about a lot of movies we watched. Laughed a little bit. It was great. It was great. Oh man, that Christmas episode with Mexican Santa Claus had me dying. Just dying. Once Jesse started describing the drunken night of making the film, oh man, it was great. So that was fun. It was just fun to listen to and rewatch old episodes of The Best of the Worst. Bassoon.
There is a second relay beacon near your position. Activate it to finish securing the hamlet.
And that was my problem, Beefcake, too. And I started watching episodes where I wasn't in the discussion because it sounded like some I would say in the discussion, but I was like, oh, but some of these episodes, I'm there during the watching of the movies, but I'm not in the discussion. So now I have to watch the whole episode in hopes that I say it during one of the watching segments. And it was a whole ordeal.
How come he's not moving?
Who?
The guy that I'm clicking on, the unit. Where is that character? I don't know anything about these games. Are you over there? Why are you over there? Real time.
I am no regrets when I pushed over the wheel. That was funny when I pushed over the wheel.
I am not fucking built for real-time strategy.
That's okay, Rich. You don't have to be. You don't have to be. Alright. Let's see what we got here. Bad news, everyone. Hi, guys. Thanks for all the great content. I'm curious to know if RLM has a new feature film in development, or if there has ever been any plans for another web series like The Grabowskis.
Excellent work, Commander.
We'll probably work on some other feature at some point in the history of time.
Yeah.
Right now, I don't believe there's anything in the works. For right now.
For right now, yep. Loner Archon says, Rich, whoever told you this is like Helldivers is a fucking liar.
No shit. It's just like Helldivers. No, but then he'll play it because it's like I said, it's like Helldivers and it's not. But he'll love it, even though he says he doesn't like RTS games. He hasn't played the right one. That's what happened.
But at the same time, calm the fuck down because you are in a tutorial on easy mode. Also, there's co-op in this game.
Yeah, but it's a tutorial that's not teaching me anything because I don't understand what I'm doing.
I feel like you're learning.
I'm just moving people.
Yeah. I feel like you're moving people with more confidence now, though.
I don't.
It looks like you are. It looks like you're moving them with more confidence. Let's see here. Sean __ says, I think most people will wait for Christmas to buy the Switch, since they will probably sell a bundle with Mario or Zelda for free. $300 with no game is a bit steep when compared to Xbox or PS4. I don't think that's true, Sean. What were PS4 selling for at launch? Hold on, I'm going to Google this. PlayStation 4 launch price.
Orcs on approach.
Come on, greenskins! Avatar's hunter and the enemy is destroying
it. Yeah, like bare bones PlayStation 4 was $350 or $400. Oh no, sorry, in US it was $400. Bare bones PS4 was $400.
Yeah.
So, this is cheaper. PS4s were $400 at launch with no game included. Oh, PS4, right? Well, you can't compare a new console to a console that has been out for X amount of years. How much was the Vita at launch? That's more comparable. And the PS4 Pro right now is $400 with no game. Yeah. Isn't next gen console? It's below current gen with gimmicks. You know, like I said, I think the amount that you will care about the Switch is exactly equal to the amount that you care about mobile gaming. For example, Rich doesn't really care about mobile gaming. Therefore, he really doesn't care about the Switch, as it offers almost nothing new besides the ability to play Nintendo games. I, on the other hand, really like mobile gaming, and while my Vita works fine, it doesn't work with everything. And so, like, a more powerful Vita is something that I am looking forward to. Which is how I'm looking at the Switch, as a souped-up Vita. Basic Vita at launch was $250. Okay, well then there you go.
Well done, Commander. With the hamlet cleared, we can secure the main route.
Vita was $250. Okay. So, like, for me, I'm excited about mobile playing. I'm excited about that. But agitating the orcs and pointing them at valuable targets. Let's see here.
We're going to win this war. We need to find out who is using the greenskins against us.
Atomic Mousetrap says the Switch is only shipping 2 million units worldwide to start. LOL, artificially manufacture my scarcity? Artificially manufacture my scarcity. Yeah.
They can say they sold out. They don't have to embarrass themselves.
Exactly. That completely, totally makes sense. Anonymous says, Jack and Rich, remember this game has an off switch and Owl Boy exists.
But I'm going to love it because it's just like Helldivers.
Rich, this is just like Helldivers. I don't know what you're talking about.
Even though that was a blatant lie, and the person who said that obviously knew better, but they were convinced that this is the game that was going to make me love the real-time strategy game. Mm-hmm. Look, this isn't the worst real-time strategy game I've ever played. It's not up my alley. Real-time strategy has never been up my alley.
Well, hey, you know what? You're playing it. Now you can talk about it with some knowledge, and then that's all that... Oh, look at him. He's a fun-looking orc. Uruk-hai, which is aimed at parents that are from the Nintendo generation. Most likely they'll buy it for their kids. You know, like, my kids really like the Wii U. They play the Wii U a lot. Like, that's their thing. The thing that I know I really like about the Wii U is that they can play on their little gamepad while something else is on the TV. That stops a ton of fights in my house.
Yep.
One wants to play a game, one wants to watch something on TV. You can do both. I thought that worked great. It just didn't have the support, didn't have the games. Didn't have the games, man. So they're space orcs. Absolutely space orcs. PSP was a portal thing that you could plug into the TV and play with a DualShock. We already had everything the Switch is promising many, many years ago. Yeah. Ah, but now it's Nintendo, so you can do it with Nintendo games. Would you buy your kids Binding of Isaac on the Wii U? I'll probably buy Binding of Isaac for the Switch, because then I can get fucking Afterbirth on it. But my kids love the Binding of Isaac. They love it. I actually probably won't buy them the Binding of Isaac for the Wii U or the Switch, because I already have it on my computer and on my Vita, so if they ever want to play the Binding of Isaac, they already can. But if I didn't already have it on my Vita, sure, I'd buy it for my Vita. They love Isaac. They love watching me play Isaac. They play Isaac. They don't get very far, but... It's going to have Afterbirth Plus on the Switch. Shit. We don't even have Afterbirth on the Vita yet. Oh man, I loved the GameCube. Jack's kid, my kids do. Oh man, my kids still ask me about Bloodborne if I'm playing a game. I'm like, okay, kids, I'm gonna play a game for a little bit. They're like, are you gonna play Bloodborne? They fucking loved watching me play Bloodborne. Which is good. I'm trying to train them right. Look at all this weird shit, kids. It's great. No, I'd buy them Isaac on the Wii U so they wouldn't want to play like it on my computer, so I could play a computer game. Am I buying my Switch for my director cousin?
Oh, God, so I hate the stressful real-time shit. I really do.
No, Jake brought bought his own Isaac on his own computer, and he got his own controller, and he lives in California, so he doesn't bother me about Isaac anymore. Rich and I will get a Switch as soon as we can, so we can do an episode on the Zelda and the Switch in general. Because I feel like we should. That's something to talk about. Alright, let's see here.
Is there a select all button, or do I just have to keep dragging?
There should be a hotkey for that. Usually I want to say there's a hotkey for that. And then like you can like hotkey specific groups, I think. All right, Dark Wing Schmuck says, I had a lazy Sunday marathon of some old streams and was curious if Mike ever got his Dr. Mario stream.
Nope.
Or if Jay ever got his Alien Isolation No Board Run, because those sound hilarious and great. Jay never did get that. Jay still struggles with basic
game mechanics.
First person controls.
Yeah, yeah. So, controls, better way to put it.
Much like our experiment with Karen and the Stanley Parable, which a rousing success. I was so happy how that turned out. I think that's going to be the biggest problem as far as Jay and Alien Isolation, or really any game we want him to play like that, is just Jay struggling with basic first-person controls. So. All right, Gabe for Jack says, have you seen Noah yet? Oh, I haven't. It's still on my shelf. It's on my shelf right next to my computer, tempting me. And I don't know why I haven't.
How do I change it? I'm assuming this is a firing arc. How do I change it?
For what? Your
grenade? Or does it automatically change? I don't understand.
For your grenade?
I'm assuming it was a fire arc? I don't really know. I'm not doing anything. They're just killing all the things, and I don't know what I would do anyway.
I would take a spot, then fortify it with sandbags. Apparently you can fortify it with sandbags. Interested to hear your thoughts also. Both of you say three nice things you like about each other. Do it. Rich is really good at articulating his thoughts.
I am?
Yeah.
No, I'm not.
You totally are. You know how to
I'm
say
good at things. Having thoughts? I think I'm bad at articulating them.
No, you're really good at articulating your thoughts. I understand what you're saying all the time.
Huh.
I understand your thoughts and ideas all the time, which is something I'm not very good at. So.
I'm assuming I'm doing good?
You seem to not be killing everyone.
I am playing on easy.
Yeah, so. Gay for Jack, I will watch Noah one of these days. It's sitting there. I borrowed it.
This is like some kind of alien language to me.
Just an RTS in
yes.
general?
Yes.
Yeah. Right click and drag to set facing. That is a different language to me, yeah. This game is like watching ants fight over crumbs at a picnic. Anonymous says, speaking of old episodes of Best of the Worst, is there any RLM prereq or Funny or Die stuff you made that you enjoy watching for entertainment, or is that too weird for you? Jack? Rich? Oh, Rich, I know your answer. Yeah, Rich does not like to watch himself.
Wait, what was this question specifically?
Do you like to watch old videos for entertainment?
I can deal with best... anything where I'm acting is bad. But, like, Best of the Worst, I can watch for entertainment.
Yeah. And I would say that as well. I, like, rewatching all these old Best of the Worst was a lot of fun. A lot of fun. And, you know, like, you forget that, like, in the older episodes, before Jay had his full beard, and you go, look at Jay without his beard. The Rich without his beard? Oh, man. It's crazy. Yeah, I can watch that stuff like that for fun. Usually if it's something I edited, I'll watch it more critically. Oh, get away from that thing.
I'm trying to. I don't know what the fuck I'm doing.
Yes, that's right. And In the first couple of episodes of Best of the Worst that I was in, I had hair. It's crazy. Not much hair, but, you know, hair. So which Best of the Worst did I enjoy the most? The Christmas one with elves and Santa Claus and Christmas Vacation 2 was really great. Oh, you know what one? The Wheel of the Worst with exploding varmints. That one had me laughing very, very hard. That was a good episode. That wheel with exploding varmints, and just trying to dissect the madness of that one guy who made it. You know, that was a great episode. I really enjoyed watching that.
If you ever watch me play XCOM, I like sit back and I take my time to think about my next move. I can't do that here. It's infuriating. There's units I'm constantly forgetting left behind. I forgot to move them. This is stressful and I hate it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I don't despise it. That would be that's a bit harsh, but
yeah.
This is not my thing. Mm-hmm. And I resent you for trying to insist it has to be. Chat. I resent you.
Okay, well there you go.
For your insistence that this is something I need in my life and that I will love despite the fact that I kind of know my taste.
Right. I also liked the playing Dangerous 2 that we took it to the gun range and shot it up. I forgot that we did that, and so we get to the tape destruction of playing Dangerous 2. Speaking of gun nuts with exploding varmints. Chat knows best. But that was great. Super great. I like my Hawaii. Apparently there's a pause key on the keyboard.
I'm sure.
And you might be able to issue commands while paused. Is what they're saying. My latest project has been trying to machine a D20 in the mill machine. Ooh, oh bother. Let me see about that. Ooh. Looks great. Looks great. All right, let's see here. Gobbledygook says, Rich, make sure you're using the minimap. There are still targets to engage. In the Titanfall video, where you guys complained that you can't tell who the bad guys are, but it's very clear in the minimap who they are, also bots versus real.
What does any of that mean? What kind of language are you speaking, sir?
Yeah, and that was a comment on that. If you remember in the Wayback Machine, our Titanfall video, one of our complaints was it was hard to distinguish who was friend and who was foe because everyone was wearing brown and green. But then in the comment section, people said if you look check the mini map, then you can tell who an enemy is. But the mini map is not what you're generally looking at.
No, that's the mini map telling who is not the problem.
Right.
I understand. I have to shoot the orcs.
He was specifically referring to a game we played a couple years ago.
I don't like trying to do tactics while in the thick of things. Jesus Christ.
Gobbledygook also says, and yeah, I'm guessing Rich is going to say, I see the minimap and I'm using it. What I mean is you could click on the minimap to go where you need to go in an RTS, not scroll manually. Embrace stress. Says
no, I don't game. You know what I do in Dead Rising, actually. The stress I love. Here, less so.
Beer and cheese is this upcoming weekend. Sorry I had to miss Sunday. I had a very important meeting. Because this weekend I will be in Madison for the Isthmus Beer and Cheese Festival. And I'll be making a video with my brother Nick and my good friend Timmy Higgins. We'll be making a beer video there. They have invited us to come and make a video for the Beer and Cheese Festival. And I'm very super excited about it. You know why? I get to be at a Beer and Cheese Fest and drink all the beer and eat all the cheese I want. It's the greatest time. It's going to be the greatest time. Jack will autograph your cheese. Oh, also, it'll be kind of strange because that very same day in Madison, there's a giant, like, march against Trump. And I'll just be like,
what good is that gonna do?
I don't know. But I just think it'll be funny because I'll have to, like, walk past them to be like, I'm gonna go to the beer festival.
He's the president for 4 years. You can march all you fucking want. What is it gonna do?
Show us out there. Yeah, I don't know. I'm not marching. I'm saying I'm going to walk past the marchers to go to the place with all the beer and cheese.
You don't have to like him, but you don't have to act like a fucking baby either.
I don't think it's acting like a baby.
Kind of is.
So what, you're just not supposed to do anything?
He won!
Right.
You vote for the next guy.
No, you show support and...
You wait till he does something you don't like before you have the march.
You go. You show your support and then, you know, like, the smaller people go there to rally their base for the next election. This is how it all starts. So your Congress people, your senators will go to that and rally support for them, and that's who you vote for the next election. It's fine. Let people do what they want, Rich. It's fine. It's fine. Thank you, Livid Liquid. We won't get into it too much. All right. Hey, guys. There are so many games on your two playlist that you generally seem interested in and we want to see. Why do you cater to those trolls who intentionally misrepresent games to get you to play them?
Solo, shut up. Look, this isn't the worst real-time game I've ever played. It's just totally not up my alley for things for the kind of things I normally like.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no, and, you know, there are a ton of games on our list, and sometimes when we can't think of something, we will default, say, like, on an XCOM or an FTL or an Isaac, you know. We will default on one of those games, which does nothing to remove a game from our list. Here, we can now cross this off of our list. We have played this, done, move on. And I think it's helpful in general. I think there part of what we do commenting on games, we also need to consume a large amount of games just to have a point of reference. So I think this is important. I think consumption is important for what we're doing.
What? I've acquired a locator beacon. Who has it? How do I use it?
I don't. Can we stop this game and go back to Frog Fractions? Oh man, I just played it. I could speed run Frog Fractions at this point. All right, let's see here. Turbo Maestro Chesto says, Jack and Rich, Prereq seems to be an ever-growing success. What do you two, Jay and Mike, and your loved ones feel about that? Also, more importantly, who would win in a fight, Batman or Captain America?
What was the actual question again?
Prereq, it's been going now. You know, we're coming up on 3 years. We have been growing. Every single stream we grow. What do we, Jay and Mike, and our loved ones feel about that?
They don't care. This is just the thing we do. They don't give a shit.
Jay and Mike still don't give a shit. I think it makes it easier for them as far as scheduling stuff. Like, for example, Jay texted me today and said, hey, you guys are streaming tonight, right? And I assumed that was going to be a text of him saying he was going to come and join us for the stream. But what that really was before you stream, we need to film a little something with you. So just a heads up, your stream's going to be late. My loved ones are still wrapping their head around what it is we do. But it makes for a very interesting conversation with family members.
So am I supposed to follow these retreating guys, would be my guess?
Is that your guy?
No, someone ran away.
Well, that probably just leads you to more bad guys, right?
That'd be my assumption.
Yeah.
Where's my goal? What am I doing? Eliminate things. All right, just kill all the things. That's my goal. All right.
Okay, great. be late. If you didn't have family, then you wouldn't be late. That's true. But, you know, it makes for interesting conversation. Especially when you start, like, breaking down, you know, what it is you do day to day. They're just like, really, huh? Just looks like you're kind of playing games and talking about shit. And I was like, well, we are, but there's so much more. As far as who would win in a fight, Batman versus Captain America, we have actually discussed this very specific topic before. And the answer is anyone with superpowers beats Batman. Because Batman is a mere mortal man.
Does Captain America have superpowers?
He has super strength. And
he has above average normal human strength.
He has super strength.
He is peak human.
Which Captain America are we talking about? Like
comic book Captain America.
Yes, he has. Well, like he can't lift a car.
No.
But he has above. He has more than human strength.
No.
He like super jumps and stuff.
No.
Punches people really hard.
Look, if there's a writer here and there who gets it wrong, that's their business. But Captain America, his power is the peak of what a human is capable of. But not to exceed that.
He is
the ideal human being. He is ironically the Nazi Aryan ideal turned against itself. That is Captain America.
I'm trying to think of a specific example where he is more than peak human, and like say in the movies.
Then that's the writers not being true to what the character is supposed to be. He's peak human.
So peak human Captain America versus Batman, who is
he's like he can run as fast as Usain Bolt, but not faster. The peak of what a human can do, that is Captain America.
Tiny Turnip says, I'm right. His superhuman abilities allowed him to survive being frozen for 75 years without aging. Cap is super soldier. Black Panther is peak human. People are agreeing with me that Captain is... He's not Spider-Man strength. I think Captain America is superhuman.
I think y'all are wrong.
I'm pretty sure Captain America benched like 2,000 pounds in the comics once. Don't you guys remember he was injected with peak serum? No, he was injected with the super soldier serum. That's right. Boom. I'm going to say Captain America has mild superhuman strength.
What does it say in the handbook to the Marvel Universe? Do you remember they used to have that?
Oh, sure.
The Marvel Handbook?
Yeah.
What does it say?
I don't know.
I know Marvel doesn't give a shit about continuity anymore. And all of that, you know, official guide to the Marvel Universe handbook stuff that the people who actually cared about the Marvel Universe well back in the day set up. I know that's all been thrown out the window.
Yep.
I'm just curious. If you look up the official Marvel handbook guide, what does it list Captain America's strength as?
Here we go. Hold on. Here we go. Someone has linked to it already. Thank you. Marvel Universe, Captain America, Steve Rogers. Citizenship, first appearance, origin. Powers. Going to powers. Where's powers? Come. Powers.
Click on it again.
Oh, there you go. Captain America represented the pinnacle of human physical perfection. He experienced a time when he was augmented to superhuman levels, but generally performed just below superhuman levels for most of his career.
Oh!
Captain America...
Oh! How interesting! All right. I was right again!
Captain America had a very high intelligence as well as agility, strength, speed, endurance, and reaction time superior to any Olympic athlete who ever competed. The super...
Reaction time.
What?
Reaction time?
They're saying agility, strength, speed, endurance, and reaction time superior to any Olympic athlete. whoever competed. The super soldier formula that he metabolized had enhanced all of his bodily functions to the peak of human efficiency. Most notably, his body eliminates the excessive buildup of fatigue, producing poisons in his muscle, granting him phenomenal endurance.
Okay.
So basically, being the peak human with
a superior endurance.
With a superior endurance that above any Olympic athlete.
It doesn't sound like by much, Jack.
It says
they're saying peak human.
They're saying peak human. I'm saying mild superpowers. I think there's an in-between zone where we can agree on.
I think you're at a level where you could make a very good argument that Batman's probably superior training in different forms of combat might give him an edge.
It's possible.
Okay.
We assume Cap is bringing the shield. Right?
Yes.
Just like
they all get their standard equipment.
They all get their standard equipment. He can leap 20 feet into the air. Great. Batman knows more combat styles, has more gadgets to ensnare Captain, right? Captain has unlimited endurance. So toe-to-toe, he would just, you know, tire Batman out.
That assumes the fight would go on well.
Right.
Mm. You can't assume that.
But you're right, Batman could just bring his Superman armor and win the day right away, so I guess there's that. Fuck you, it's superhero talk. Yeah, you know. I mean, all right, I get, like, under the correction that Captain America is peak human.
Yeah.
You might have to give that to Batman.
Okay.
Might have to give that. I don't like giving it to Batman. But you might.
Batman. I like Captain America, but if you're going to be honest about who would win in a fight, not do the fanboy, yeah. Well, I like Thor and Thor better.
Right. Yeah, no, I, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying you might be right. Target sighted. We are your death, Greenskin. To settle the debate, you need to look no further than Michael Van Patrick. Who's Michael Van Patrick? Michael Van Patrick, Earth 616. Oh, God. No, that's too much. I'm not reading that. I don't know what it is. Yeah, you know what? I think you got a fair case for Batman. Got a fair case for Batman. All right. Gobbledygook says, also, congratulations. This is a real PC game for real PC gamers.
Okay.
So good job, Rich.
Yeah, that's not like I've ever played real PC games before.
Peak human means best, meaning Cap is better at all the things the really good human Batman is being better than the really good human Batman.
You know. Physically, as far as strength goes. But what does that say about abilities,
right.
Skills?
Batman's a ninja. He's studied several different versions of martial arts, and I'm sure Captain America, you know, he knows a little of that WW2 boxing, but yeah, Batman could probably win. That make a problem. Renegade Akira says, hey, JNR, what's the remake you're dreading becomes a reality? I can only imagine that Back to the Future will have a Chinese girl for diversity and money, and The Rock as Doc Brown. You know what? Now I just kind of want to see that one. That would be so effed up. I'd love it. I'd love it. Batman's only real advantage IMO is stealth. Well, Batman has stealth. Batman has more gadgets. and Batman knows more fighting styles. So I think Batman has a few advantages. You know, Captain's reaction time is good, so probably Batarangs would be useless. But heck, even, you know, even amateur Spider-Man was able to web up Captain a couple times in Civil War. So I bet Batman would be able to lasso him at least a few times, then use his sweet ninja moves. You know, as far as remakes, I'm dreading. You know, I don't really dread many things. No remake can undo the original movie. I've been hearing some pretty bad things out of the Jumanji camp. Just to talk about a recent remake. I think they're going in a strange direction with the Jumanji thing, but you know, I also don't hate The Rock. I think he's fine. They're saying movie Cap can beat movie Batman.
Probably movie Cap. He seems to be far more than human.
Yeah, I think movie Cap is like a sub super.
Oh, I pulled that one out of my ass.
You sure did.
You know why? Because I was left with one guy and I could focus on what I was doing. Honestly, that's what happened. The clusterfuck was gone because everyone else was dead. And I'm like, all right, I can focus now.
They're going a weird direction. Like, do you know the thing about the new Jumanji? Do you know what the thing is? The new
I don't care enough about Jumanji, really. The first one is like, eh.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's fun. It's a fun movie. I like Jumanji. Like, I'm not a Jumanji hardcore fan or anything. But the give with the new Jumanji is they get sucked into a video game. And the kids, when they're sucked into a video game, turn into their video game characters. That's where you get The Rock from.
Okay.
And so it's The Rock with the mind of a child inside the jungle.
Okay.
I think that, you know what, there's a fine kids movie premise in there, and we'll see how they handle it. I think it could be fine. And Karen Gillan's in it, so that double score. Deploy to the surface as soon as your squads are ready. Like Nick Arcade?
Are we okay with switching games? Not that I hate this. I'm not saying I hate this, but I'm not a real-time strategy
guy. You're
just
kind of apathetic towards it?
And I tried it after everyone bitched at me. You got to play it. You got to play. All right.
We can absolutely switch games. You want to switch games?
Yeah.
Let's do it. You want me to play a little bit?
You know what? I'm gonna switch to the other Warhammer game.
Oh, okay.
That's not a real-time strategy.
Sure. So I think I'm going to do. That's fine. Do that. Right. 1 hour, 27 minutes. Hey, everyone, why don't we do a little stand-up time?
How do I save and exit here? Is the Steam constant interruptions covering up important things? Yep, that was.
That's so funny. We're probably not going to finish Frog Fractions 2. I just don't think we care enough.
I was watching Awesome Games Done Quick was last week.
Yeah.
I was watching that.
True.
You know what they played?
Huh.
Undertale.
Oh, yeah?
There's a lot more. It wasn't just a little bit that we didn't see.
Yeah.
There was a lot more. Mm-hmm. I don't know if we have our old save file anymore. But it looked like there was a decent chunk of stuff, Jack.
I honestly don't care.
Did you not like the game? I'm kind of curious.
I didn't.
No?
No.
I thought it was clever.
Yeah. You know what it was? It was really cute. Oh, what happened?
We exited to Windows and we never quite got there.
Are we still streaming?
Type it in.
They just said Undertale more like Blundertale. So. But voices. Jack. Yeah, I think we're still streaming.
Well, I have two black screens.
We do. We have two black screens. Okay, yeah, we're still streaming. Okay, but so before we have to shut down the computer.
We're going to have to.
And restart the stream. Undertale was really cute.
Yeah.
and it was a fine play. I just didn't feel very interested in it.
I find that shocking.
Whereas, like, we had a lot of fun playing it too.
Yeah. That's why I find it shocking. There was a lot of fun, cute, clever things going on in Undertale.
There were. What I'm trying to say is, I think if I were playing it by myself, it would be just kind of a meh experience. So the fun I get from it, it's like, oh yeah, me and Rich played it and we did funny voices and that was kind of silly.
I think the voices made it unbearable for you.
What do you mean?
Doing the voice for, what was his name?
Oh no, I liked that.
You like that?
Oh, I thought it was fun. Like, yeah, okay. We did weird voices. That's where I got the enjoyment out of it.
Papyrus had a lot of dialogue.
And
a lot of high energy voice you were using. I could see it if you couldn't deal with that, but.
But I loved it and, you know, killed my voice, but it was hilarious. And I had a great time playing because I was playing with you in the stream. If I were playing that same game by myself, I probably wouldn't have even gotten like an hour past it. Like, I get it. I got it.
It was like, constantly being clever. I might have enjoyed that on my own.
Yeah. Whereas, like,
I didn't play it on my own. It's hard to say for 100% sure, but
like a game like Inside, I could really get, and I could see myself like getting to the end and really loving it.
Less so Inside, a lot less Inside for me.
Yeah.
Like the light puzzles you got on that. Yeah.
Yeah, but I feel like I would have gotten through that a lot faster, and then the ending was so worth it. So.
Okay.
Yeah. It was fun, I'm not saying it's a bad game. I'm even saying I enjoyed it and it was cute, but yeah, just, you know, I wasn't super into it. But here's the thing, Rich. If you want to replay it on stream and get to the ending, I'm perfectly okay with that. I'm apathetic towards it.
Okay.
Is what I'm saying.
Oh, I'm supposed to hate Undertale because it's JRPG inspired. Even though the combat itself is nothing like the JRPG combat that I despise. Like old school JRPG combat.
It has the old school JRPG preface, but then you actually do something.
Yeah, it's like a bullet hell game. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Just like a JRPG.
But it's the same thing because we are dumb and we cannot get past these superficial surface things.
Yep.
Because Dawn of War 2 is exactly like Helldivers.
Okay, so everyone, we have two black screens here.
And we're going to have to restart the computer.
We have to restart the computer. We'll be back. We'll be back with more Warhammer.
Yeah, I think Space Marine.
Okay, cool. So we'll be back. Take a break, stand up, and do all the things you do. It's called Space Marine?
Yeah.
Is it Dawn of War 2?
No.
It's just Dawn of War Space Marine?
It's just Warhammer 40K.